Good evening, and welcome to the public hearing on the revised proposed rule published in the Federal Register on Tuesday, September 27, 2011, by the United States Fish and Wildlife Service. For simplicity tonight, I may refer to the revised proposed rule simply as the proposed rule or the rule. I may also refer to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service as the service or the agency. Public hearings are one way the service solicits information and comments from the public on a proposed rule. Tonight, you will have an opportunity to present your comments on the proposal to designate critical habitat for the Mississippi gopher frog. The rule has several aspects the service will discuss in a few minutes. The purpose of the hearing is to give you, the public, an opportunity to participate in the decision-making process by providing your comments. Two types of comments will be received, oral and written. Each type will be considered equally by the service. Your comments are a necessary and important part of this process. The service must and will consider the public's comments in finalizing the currently proposed rule and the draft economic analysis. When I say currently proposed, I use those words intentionally. At this point, it is very important to note that no final decisions have been made. Please come to order. The time is now 7:13. My name is Judy Kelly. I am an attorney with the U.S. Department of the Interior in the Office of the Solicitor. I work in the Regional Solicitor's Office in Atlanta. The service asked our office to provide a hearing officer, and I will serve as your moderator. I am not employed by the Fish and Wildlife Service or involved in any way in the decision-making process. When the hearing concludes tonight, my duties will be completed. I am here solely to moderate this hearing as an impartial presence. My responsibility is to maintain an orderly hearing and ensure that everyone requesting an opportunity to speak will have a fair and equal opportunity to be heard. It is also my job to keep the speakers to their allotted time limits because right now, we have about 17 people signed up to speak. I believe we have a number of, of elected officials with us tonight? Are there any elected officials who wish to be recognized at this time? There are none. I'd like to recognize several agency officials and introduce the people seated here with me at the table. Seated at my left is Ms. Erin Rubenbart, who will provide the Fish and Wildlife Service's opening remarks. Erin is the regional listing biologist with the service's Southeast office, the regional office in Atlanta. She has worked with the agency for over 11 years and has been in the listing program since 2003. Seated to my right is Linda LeClaire, who is a wildlife biologist in the Fish and Wildlife Service's Mississippi Field Office in Jackson, Mississippi. Linda has worked for the service for 20 years. She is the listing and recovery lead for the Mississippi gopher frog. She will provide some species information about the Mississippi gopher frog and talk about the proposed critical habitat designation. Seated in the audience is Mr. Mark Ewan, who is the Principal and Managing Director of Industrial Economics Incorporated, a contractor of the service located in Cambridge, Massachusetts. Mr. Ewan will present slides and speak about the draft economic analysis. Following the comments of Ms. Rubenbart, Ms. LeClaire, and Mr. Ewan, public comments will be received. However, I'd like to acknowledge a few other service officials who are here tonight as well. Attending from the Mississippi office in Jackson, Mississippi are Ms. Karen Northwest in the back of the room, back of the auditorium, Ms. Connie Dickard, Public Affairs Specialist, Mr. Paul McCase, a biologist in the back of the room, Mr. Randy Browning, a biologist. You are Randy? Oh, outside? Okay. And Mr. Scott Wiggers, a botanist. There's Scott. I believe Scott is also going to be our timekeeper tonight, is that true? The hearing was scheduled to begin at 7 p.m. and we started at 7:13. It is scheduled to conclude at 9 o'clock. However, since we have a good number of people who are signed up to speak, we may not adhere to the official proposed ending time. We'll just see. I may need to keep the hearing open longer than the scheduled time if it's necessary to do so, to make sure that each person who wishes to speak may do so. The Fish and Wildlife Service will maintain a written record of tonight's proceedings. To ensure there is an accurate, complete record, we have a court reporter who will record and transcribe all your comments. If you wish to receive a copy of the transcript, please make arrangements directly with the court reporter. Her name is Ms. Kathy Wilkinson of Simpson, Burdine, and Miguez. She is seated to my right in the red shirt. Her phone number is 228-863-4445. I'll repeat that. 228-863-4445. The hearing format tonight has three parts. First, I will explain how the hearing will be conducted. In the second part, Ms. Rivenbark and Ms. LeClaire will talk about the proposal, and Mr. Ewan will present information on the draft economic analysis. In the third and major part, we will be receiving your comments. I'd like to go over the process and a few ground rules with you now. Speaker registration cards were placed at the table where you registered outside the auditorium. Before the hearing started, people wishing to speak had an opportunity to complete those cards, and I will use the cards in calling speakers to the microphone. There are two microphones, I believe, one located in each aisle, about four rows from the front. If you have not completed a card but would like to speak, I encourage you to fill out a card now. There are Fish and Wildlife representatives around the auditorium who will give you one if you raise your hand or speak to them. I don't see any hands. When your name is called, is there one?
Sorry,
okay, if there's anyone who did not have a chance to fill out a card and wants to do so now, we'll be happy to have you fill it out, and the Fish and Wildlife Service will bring it, and I'll add it to the cap. No, go ahead with the card. When your name is called, please come to a microphone, state your name clearly, and spell your last name for the court reporter. Because we want to hear from each of the people who signed up tonight, we will be limiting the time for each speaker to 5 minutes. No one needs to use all of their designated time, of course. Also, if you registered to speak but change your mind, for example, if you believe other speakers have said what you plan to say, you do not need to speak. Please let me know that when I call on you, and you do not need to get up. To help you keep track of your time, the timekeeper, Scott, will hold up a card. Can you show us what the card looks like, please? He will show a card Hold up the card to show when you have 1 minute left to speak. That would be your warning signal. If you are still speaking, when you see the second card says no minutes remaining. You do not have to stop in mid-sentence. Please finish your thought and then we'll move to the next person. If you are not able to complete your oral comments during the allotted time, you can supplement them in writing and present additional written comments to the service if you like. I ask you to keep a few important points in mind. First, although this is not a formal court proceeding, we would like to keep the hearing demeanor similar to what you would expect to find in the courtroom. No one will present testimony under oath, however, or be asked any questions or subjected to cross-examination. The hearing will not include open dialogue or debate. There will be no debate between anyone in the audience and the Fish and Wildlife Service, nor between any members of the audience. Also, no one will be granted rebuttal time. That is, you will not be given a second chance to get up and speak again when your turn is over. When it is your turn, please keep your comments focused on the proposal. If someone should happen to stray off the subject or run past their time, I may interrupt and ask them to return to the subject or to finish their thought. The hearing does not include an oral question and answer session. There was an opportunity to ask questions during the informational meeting held at 6 o'clock just before the hearing started. Now, during the hearing, the audience does not ask questions. You are encouraged, however, to submit any questions and, of course, any comments you may have to the service in writing. If you have written comments with you tonight, comments or questions, you can give them to me after the hearing, and I will give them to the Fish and Wildlife Service, or you can give them to a Fish and Wildlife employee before you leave. Please be sure not to interrupt a speaker if you need to leave while someone is still at the microphone. If you have written comments and questions you do not wish to submit tonight, you may submit them electronically at the federal e-rulemaking portal, regulations.gov, or by U.S. mail or hand delivery to public comments process. This is the address. And you have the information in a handout, one of the tables in the back. It's not. The address is Comments Processing, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, Arlington, Virginia. The address for mail delivery and instructions for submitting comments on the e-rulemaking portal are shown in the proposed rule published in the Federal Register on September 27, 2011. The Federal Register notice announcing the hearing and the reopening of comments, of the comment period. Instructions are also in the materials made available tonight. All comments must be received by March 2nd, 2012, by 11:59 Eastern Standard Time. I have a few requests for you now. I ask that everyone in the audience show courtesy to each speaker, whether you agree or not with what is being said. Also, to ensure that the court reporter is able to hear and record everything that is being said, I ask everyone to refrain from applauding or making any loud or disruptive noises. Everyone who wishes to make a comment about the proposal should be allowed to do so in a non-adversarial atmosphere. I appreciate your help in maintaining a respectful tone and setting tonight. I also remind you that not everyone is an experienced public speaker or comfortable at the microphone. Some are nervous, some may be timid, Some possibly would not come forward in an unfriendly or inhospitable setting. To make sure everyone is given a fair opportunity to be heard, I ask for your cooperation. We want every single speaker to be able to come comfortably to the microphone and present their comments. I have one last request before we begin. Although you may think you already have silenced your cell phone or turned it off, I ask you, as I would with my own, to double check that now so we don't have any interruptions during the hearing. Thank you. Mine's on vibrate, right? With the preliminary matters behind us now, we move to the second part of the public hearing. At this time, Ms. Erin Ruth-Mark will begin the agency's presentation. Erin?
Thank you, Judy. Are we okay?
Can you hear me?
Address already mentioned by Judy and available in the back, or submit them online at www.regulations.gov, which you'll also see again in presentations tonight. We must receive your comments by the closing date of March 2nd, 2012 by 11:59 p.m. Eastern Time. If you have already submitted comments on the September 27, 2011 revised proposed rule, there is no need to resubmit them. We will incorporate them into the public record as part of this comment period, and we will fully consider them in the preparation of our final determination. Our final determination will take into consideration all written comments and public testimony from this hearing. The comments and information you provide to us are important in that they allow us to use the best and most current scientific and commercial data available regarding proposed critical habitat, the revised methodology, and the draft economic analysis for the species. Specifically, we are seeking comments regarding, one, the reasons why we should or should not designate habitat as critical habitat under Section 4 of the Endangered Species Act, including whether there are threats to the species from human activity, the degree of which can be expected to increase due to the designation, and whether that increase in threat outweighs the benefit of designation such that the designation of critical habitat may not be proven. Two, specific information on A, the amount and distribution of Mississippi gopher frog habitat, B, what areas that were occupied at the time of listing or are currently occupied and that contain the features essential to the conservation of the species should be included in this designation and why. C, special management considerations or protection that may be needed in critical habitat areas we are proposing, including managing for the potential effects of climate change. And D, what areas not occupied at the time of listing are essential for the conservation of the species and why. Three, land use designations and current or planned activities in the subject areas and their possible impacts on proposed critical habitat. Four, information on the projected and reasonably likely impacts of climate change on the Mississippi gopher frog and proposed critical habitat. Five, any probable economic, national security, or other relevant impacts of designating any area that may be included in the final designation. Excuse me. In particular, we seek information on any impacts on small entities or families and the benefits of including or excluding areas that exhibit these impacts. Number six, whether any specific areas we are proposing for critical habitat designation should be considered for exclusion under Section 4B2 of the Endangered Species Act, and whether the benefits of potentially excluding any specific area outweigh the benefits of including that area under Section 4B2 of the Act. Seven, whether we could improve or modify our approach to designation of critical habitat in any way to provide for greater public participation and understanding or to better accommodate public concerns and comments. Eight, the appropriateness of the taxonomic change in the Mississippi goat frog from Rana capitosilosa to Rana silosa. Nine, the appropriateness of the methodology used for delineating the proposed critical habitat, including any data that might help further refine these areas. Please keep in mind that while economic impacts could not be considered under ESA for the original listing of the species because the Act specifically restricts this, that they are considered during the designation of critical habitat, which is why an economic analysis has been done. Critical habitat receives protection under Section 7 of the Act through the requirement that federal agencies ensure, in consultation with the service, that any action they authorize, fund, or carry out is not likely to result in the destruction or the adverse modification of critical habitat. The designation of critical habitat does not affect land ownership or establish a refuge, wilderness, reserve, preserve, or other conservation area. Designation does not allow the government or the public access to private lands. The designation does not require implementation of restoration, recovery, or enhancement measures by non-federal landowners. Where a landowner seeks or requests federal agency funding or authorization for an action that may affect a listed species or critical habitat, the consultation requirements of Section 782 would apply. But even in the event of a destruction or adverse modification finding that
I'm even having problems hearing.
Speak to us and see how that sounds, and turn the air conditioner off. Would you do that, ma'am?
I think having two microphones on is why you're getting the feedback. Being
the other one wasn't on until just now, but well,
that's
we shut that one off.
That's better.
Okay, I'm going to start that paragraph over. Where a landowner seeks or requests federal agency funding or authorization for an action that may affect a listed species or critical habitat, the consultation requirements of Section 782 of the ESA would apply. But even in the event of a destruction or adverse modification finding that indicates that critical habitat may be destroyed or the value reduced by an action, the obligation of the federal action agency and the landowner is not to restore or recover the species, but to implement reasonable and prudent alternatives to avoid destruction or adverse modification of critical habitat. In closing, I would like to assure you that we take your comments very seriously. Please be aware that questions submitted here and throughout all open comment periods which are relevant to the designation of critical habitat for this species will be addressed in the final rule. We hope everyone was available to attend the informational meeting from 6 to 7, which was our question and answer session of the evening. And now during the public hearing portion of the night, we are pleased to listen to the public's comments regarding the revised proposal. Thank you very much. And now I'd like to introduce you to Linda LeClaire, biologist from the Mississippi Field Office, who is going to tell us a little bit about the designation and the Mississippi Gopher Frog.